Now that we've dealt with mechanical waves, we've got to start looking at electromagnetic waves. That's waves in a vacuum. And for us to do that, we just need to revisit, I think, Maxwell's equations. And they were Gauss's law of the electric field, Gauss's law of the magnetic field, Faraday's law of induction, and then Ampere's law, or the Ampere-Maxwell law, if you put the displacement current together with Ampere's law. Now let's start quickly with Gauss's law of the electric field, which states that electric flux equals the integral over a whole surface of the dot product of the electric field and the area vector. And the area vector, and what we will see is that equals Q enclosed, or then epsilon zero Q enclosed, the enclosed charge enclosed in that surface. Let's quickly look how we derive this. We looked initially at air going through an empty photo frame. And if we had our photo frame there and the air going through it, and we could change this, just the view that we have to side on, so I take this frame and I turn it side on, that was the frame, that was the air moving through it, perpendicular to this area of mine, I draw an area vector, so that was my area vector, that was the velocity of the air or any kind of fluid that was moving through that specific square. And if I wanted to know what the flow rate was, remember flow rate, think about it, that will be cubic meters per second. All I did is I multiplied those with each other, and I said VA, which in unit notation was meters per second times square meter. In other words, we were going to get cubic meters per second flowing through there. Another thing we looked at is, say for instance, this flow is not perpendicular to the side-on view of the area, but say for instance I'm viewing this from the top. Now I'm viewing it from the top, and there is my area vector, but I notice that my velocity, my flow, is now in this direction. In other words, let's say that is now my velocity vector, so magnitude and direction. If the angle between these was theta, if that was the angle between them, and I wanted to look what the component is of my velocity vector along A, that will just be V cosine of theta. V cosine of theta will be this component here. And if I multiply those two with each other, it would be VA cosine of theta. And we know that if that's magnitude, if we change that into vectors, that is just going to be the velocity vector dot product with the area vector. And all we did here was to say, look, let's not make this flow rate velocity of a fluid, let's make that the electric field. Let's make that the electric field. So we were just going to get electric field dot product with the area vector. Well, I should just say E dot A. Okay, so what we did as well as just look at, let us just look at any surface, not just a rectangular surface, but let's enclose a charge. We enclose a charge by an imaginary surface. And because we are dealing in electricity with monopoles, in other words, any point particle I have, electron or proton for our purposes, is a point charge, say the electron there. So it will, rather it will have an electric field. And the electric field lines, well, let's make it easier, let's make this a proton. Let's make this a positive charge, a proton. And anywhere in a three-dimensional sphere around that, is going to experience these vectors going outwards, which is the electric field. The electric field goes out from the point charge and goes through our imaginary, our imaginary surface, just as much as the air was flowing through our frame there. And what we did is, we can just take a small area there, and we'll call that delta, and we can make small areas out of this whole thing, and they each have a small little area called, we'll call delta area, so we'll just sum up all of those, so that they'll just be the sum of the electric field dot product with delta A. Our small, these are our small areas. And we know we can go from this to an integral if we just let delta L get smaller and smaller and smaller. So we're looking at the integral going through the whole surface of E dot dA. Okay, so now we're at least at this part, and we call this flux. Flux, electric flux. Amount of cubic meters per second, but this will now just be electric field going through that area. Okay, and we call this the flux, the amount of electric field that flows through, if you can think about it as a flow, but remember there's no flow, it's a field, the vector field. And what we noticed, what was noticed, what we need to take cognizance of is the fact that this electric flux is proportional to the enclosed electric field, the enclosed charge, I should say. So if I have one proton there, there will be a certain flux through the surface. If I put two protons there, the flux will immediately be double. There's proportionality, and the constant of proportionality is the permittivity constant, epsilon zero, Q enclosed. In other words, here we have Gauss's law of the electric field, that the integral to the whole surface of the dot product of the electric field and the area vector equals the permittivity constant times the enclosed charge. Okay, so that's a short summary then of the first law, Maxwell's first equation, Gauss's law of the electric field. We'll go through all four of them. In similar vein, let's now quickly look at Gauss's law for the magnetic field, and that is also about flux. Of a magnetic field now is also an integral over through the whole surface, so exactly the same concept as the electric field. Now we're just going to have the magnetic field dot product with the small differential areas. And what we will notice is that that has got to equal zero. That's got to equal zero. And the reason being is in electricity we have a point charge, an electric monopole. It's not really a pole, it's an electric monocharge. It's positive or negative. We're not talking about a neutron in as much as I can isolate a negative charge and a positive charge. When it comes to a magnet though, I cannot isolate a north pole or a south pole. If I have a bar magnet, north pole, south pole, a south pole, I break it in two, each piece will have a north and a south pole. So we're talking about magnetic dipoles here. So when I do have my little magnet, I have these, this is north and south, I have these emanating magnetic field lines. And now, if I draw a Gauss surface here, just as many lines will go out as they come back in. The net flux through that imaginary Gauss surface, the net flux through that has got to be zero. Even if I draw a line here, and you'll think, well, there's a lot of lines going out of it, but just as many are coming back in. Okay, so even through that, just isolating the north pole there. And in that isolation, there is a south pole as well, in as much as the field lines, the magnetic field lines will enter my surface again. So the net flux through any surface is zero, purely because I cannot isolate a pole. There's always a magnetic dipole in any Gaussian, imagine a Gaussian surface that I draw around a magnet, whether that's a bar magnet or electrical carrying, a current carrying coil or whatever the arrangement might be, electromagnet or bar magnet. The flux, and there's my integral for it, has got to be zero.